Now, Property Monday continues as Margaret Lomas and her team answer all on Your Money, Your Call.
Hello and welcome back to Your Money, Your Call. I'm Margaret Lomas from Destiny Financial Solutions, and it's great to have you on board this evening. We're certainly looking forward to a great night ahead. Now, this week we're going to be taking a look at the proposed new Northern Beaches Tunnel in Sydney and also talking about repairs and maintenance from the tenant's point of view. And to help me with those topics and, of course, to answer your calls, I've invited in tonight regulars Noel Petrohelos from BMT Tax Depreciation and Rich Harvey from Property Buyer, who are experts in these topics. So tonight's your chance to get your depreciation questions and any questions about property investing answered. You can contact us at any time during the show with your comments and any questions about these topics and more. The number to call is 1300 30 34 35, or send a tweet to me at Margaret Lomas AU with the hashtag YMYC, or an email to property@skynews.com.au. It's great to have you on board, and let's go straight to the latest property news. And tenants advice and advocacy service branches across New South Wales take regular calls of concern from tenants fearing that they'll be evicted or given a rent rise should they make complaints or regularly ask for repairs. Julia Murray from the Inner Western Sydney Tenants Advice Service said the calls were almost daily regarding ignored maintenance requests and the consequences of going to the tribunal. For those coming up to the end of a fixed term lease, with 30 days notice from landlords required to end a tenancy, and periodic tenancies with 90 days notice requirements, it seems that tenants can't assert their rights without fearing that they'll have to move. A spokesperson from New South Wales Fair Trading said tenants were protected under the Residential Tenancies Act 2010, which could find the termination of a tenancy to be retaliatory in certain circumstances. Welcome to the program to you both.
Great to be on, Margaret.
How weird is it sitting here on this new set?
It's a lovely new set, isn't it?
I know. As I said to you all before we started, I feel like really tiny here. And I've got you all on this side of me now instead of being in between.
We're just your right-hand men, see? Yeah,
exactly, you definitely are. Let's talk about the news story that we've got leading tonight. Noel, you sent this one over to me because
I did.
You had a little bit of a concern about it. What in particular did you want to discuss?
Well, to me it just seems really strange and a little amateurish for a landlord to be knocking back on simple basic repairs and potentially risking losing a tenant for a short amount of time just to go with, you know, to not spend that little bit of money on a repair. Mm. I'm not, you know, the article was a little bit vague as to how frequent it happens, and obviously they're getting calls from tenants. And, you know, it would be difficult to prove, you know, if a tenant was going to end up being evicted because of complaining like that, it'd be difficult to prove. Mm. But to me, I mean, I've been in property investing for about 15 years, and for me, long term, it's always better just to, you get those good tenants to keep them happy and do those little bits and pieces. And the example in this article was talking about a stovetop and, you know, and some very basic things.
And those things are depreciable anyway, so you get them and you get a tax deduction.
Definitely. I mean, it's a lot of that stuff is repairs and maintenance. So if you're bringing an item back to its situation that it was in when you purchased or maintaining, then that's a 100% deduction straight away within that year. Mm. If you are improving, then it becomes a capital improvement, and that's something that depreciates over time. But you see this pop up every now and again, and I was a little surprised reading about it, just from that perspective, because it's not, to me, it's just not the smartest move. And if you're a landlord out there, I just like the message to get across that long term, it's better to do those little bits and pieces. And even when you, for me personally, when you're going through a change of lease, it doesn't hurt to have a good thorough look through your property and just get it tenant ready and get it ready for that year, so you don't have to be going through these bits and pieces throughout the year. Mm. And things do pop up though.
Mm. Rich, there's a couple of issues for me here in this one. And the first one is that really people should know when they become a property investor that it's not about set and forget, that you do have to continually do repairs and maintenance. Mm. And you've got to look after your tenant. Not just because you want to, but because it's law to do so.
That's right.
But secondly, It's kind of like not looking after that new car that you buy, isn't it? Mm. It's maintenance of your asset.
That's right.
And while we don't mind it depreciating on paper, we don't really want it to depreciate in real life. We don't want it to be worth less. We want it to be worth what we paid for it and more.
I think I was quite surprised when I read this story. I think it's a bit of fear-mongering as well, because I think any decent landlord, you've got an obligation to have a really safe environment for your tenant, and it's really important that you have the stovetop working, that you have an air condition working. And as Noel said, they're all depreciable items. So it's really important that landlords look after their properties, and they're going to get the maximum rent for that. And tenants shouldn't live in fear. I think it's the worst sort of scenario to be living in fear and complaining about something for fear of being kicked out in the street. That's a terrible situation. Mm. Any good landlord should definitely look after the property and make sure their tenant's cared for. I think it's just absolutely essential.
Noel, I don't know if you're aware, but in South Australia, they actually have a law that says that landlords have to do this maintenance. Mm. And they have a situation whereby if you're not doing the right kind of maintenance, your tenant has a place they can go and complain. Mm. And then you actually get a letter from that body as the landlord saying that you're no longer allowed to charge that rent and you've got to reduce your rent or fix the problem. Mm-hmm. And sometimes they go a bit overboard. Like all bodies like this, sometimes they can be, you know, a little too all-powerful. And so I've had clients who have received ridiculous letters over ridiculous things.
And that's the problem. You see something like that getting taken out of, you know, out of context, and you'll end up with a very simple scenario getting big. But there's another little trick that people need to be aware of, and the scrapping potential. Mm-hmm. If there's an asset, when they've acquired an asset within a property, an asset like an old stove or an old hot water system, and they go out there and have a look at it, and it's just not worth fixing up. If they remove that asset has a value, even though it might be an old stove. They've purchased that asset with that purchase of that property. So a percentage of that purchase price can be attributed towards that asset. So when we're valuing the assets for depreciation purposes, we take that into consideration. Now, that whole stove, if it's not worth fixing, it gets scrapped. There's no monetary value for the stove. It can't be sold. It's scrapped. That whole value that we put on that asset can be written off 100%, and then you can start to depreciate the new asset. Now, once you go through that process and you work out that deduction is at your taxable, your marginal tax rate, you'd nearly be square. Yeah, and you've got a brand new stove.
I love scrapping. Scrapping's one of my favourite little things that you can actually get, you know, it works, and it does make it easier to replace those things when you want to.
Definitely.
Yeah, but I think it's also important, Margaret, that you've got to have a property that's fit for habitation and fit for use. And I think you want your tenants to stay long term. So as Noel said, if you have all those things fixed, you're going to have a good quality tenant. They're going to stay longer. They won't be looking for another property, and you won't have a vacancy issue when they move out.
And my experience, that's more important in the long run.
You know what? I think part of this story is also about, I don't know if you guys have noticed, but I've noticed that younger generation, the 20s to 30s, they don't actually complain about stuff that much. You know, if I go out to a restaurant with my kids, who are all adults, and I get, say, a steak that isn't done right, they refuse to let me send it back because they say the kitchen will spit on it before it comes back. And they hate making complaints about anything. They actually do put up with stuff. And I wonder if a lot of these people in this particular article are the younger generation who do live in fear because they don't understand their rights. Mm. They don't understand that they have these rights, that there are laws to protect them, and therefore they think that the landlord is all-powerful and they're not game enough to make those complaints.
Could be the case, for sure. And a lot of them have gone through a lot to get those properties in the location that they want, and, you know, they might be in the scenario where they're thinking, I've got to hang on to that.
Yeah, exactly.
But I think there's a difference between those who complain all the time, like a tenant's complaining about every little thing that's wrong, versus someone that's got a genuine issue.
Absolutely. Yeah. Mm. Well, look, let's kick off our emails this evening with a question from Nakul. And Nakul asks, what do you think about investing in student accommodation? My number crunching tells me the return could be 4 to 5%. But this is based on conservative estimates of occupancy at 40 weeks, factoring in summer vacation, and then another 15% vacancy at any given time of the year. I'm going to go to you first, Rich, and let me tell you what worries me about questions like this. They're all about the asset and the rent. Nowhere in this email did Nakul even mention where this particular accommodation was. For all we know, it could be in some whoop-whoop town with a little, you know, campus.
With a little university.
Far-flung campus, you know, school of the air campus. But you understand the point that I'm
absolutely
making.
Yeah. I think my advice to Nicole is, number one, look, there is a shortage of student accommodation in Australia at the moment. There's some large accommodation providers that are very active in the market, and it's been proven that there's a shortage of supply. It doesn't mean that everyone should invest in student accommodation. It's a very specialised kind of investment, and that's my concern, Margaret, is that if Nicole doesn't have many properties and he's going straight to one asset class with a real small subsector of property investment, it can only be used generally for more students. Now, students are generally a little bit harder on the property, so there may be slightly higher maintenance. There is obviously, he's already factored in a much higher vacancy factor. That's what worries me about this investment. But as you pointed out, the location is absolutely critical. If you're going to invest in student accommodation at all, if it stacks up, it must be very, very close, almost within walking distance to the university, certainly within walking distance to a train or a bus. And just be very, very careful to have a really good manager that doesn't take too much of the rent, because there are higher management fees as well.
Noel, years ago I owned 4 units in Armidale, right near the university.
Yep.
And they were really good positive cash flow, but in the end they drove me crazy because those students couldn't even change a light bulb on their own.
And they were probably putting complaints in.
Well, every time I put a rental statement, it was like decimated with the amount of stuff I'd had to pay out for really simple things that someone else would have been able to do for themselves.
And
I got rid of them.
Armidale's a beautiful little town, though, isn't it? But, you know, it really depends on your long-term strategy. If your strategy is there to get some high yields, get that cash flow and not worry too much about capital growth, then, you know, it's always good to have a combination of both. So if you can have, some student accommodation that has a really good rental return in more of a metro area that's not only leaning on a university but maybe some other infrastructure, then it's not such a bad thing. Because they're furnished, the depreciation deductions are really high. We do thousands of university accommodation, and that furniture makes a huge difference to the depreciation potential therefore the cash flow, because that carries on to the yearly return. But each of those furniture items, along with the carpets, blinds, light fittings, hot water system, all those assets, beds, desks, computers, they all depreciate fairly quickly.
Cash flow person, you just think about the depreciation, don't you?
Look, that's what our job is, to help people get that return. But you know, a mixture of both cash flow and capital growth.
Absolutely, all in the one.
It's a good recipe. It's a good recipe.
Nakul, let me tell you what worries me the most about all of this. Whenever we buy a niche market property, and in that I include student accommodation, hotel rooms or service departments, and seniors accommodation, people buy them because they like the look of the cash flow, but they don't think about the fact that cash flow is what keeps you in the market, and capital growth is what ultimately gets you out of the market with a nest egg to allow you to be financially independent in retirement. Typically, these kinds of niche market property don't grow that well because they are cash flow investments and they have their own little problems. You've already pointed out that you have greater vacancy. That limits the amount of people who will be happy to get into an investment like that. So you have a limited resale market. And if we look at history, we don't see these kinds of units or apartments or even houses growing that well because of the niche market that they apply to. The two most important things for you when you're looking to buy an investment property is, first of all, buying it in a location where you know there is going to be future growth. Now, that doesn't mean a capital city necessarily. It means identifying an area where we've got population growth, median household income growth, and lots of infrastructure, so you know it's going to grow in the future. And the second thing that you need to know when you're buying a property is that you're going to have that good resale market, because that will also help it to grow. The third thing that you need to know when you're buying niche market property is that you should only ever buy one that can easily be converted into a normal unit. So if the purpose fails, so if you can no longer rent it to tenants, or suddenly the tenant market dries up, or something changes, or there's too many of them on the market and an oversupply, which also tends to happen with these things, you can rent yours out to anyone, not just the student market. So if you are considering this one seriously, first of all, make sure it's in a good area. And second of all, make sure that if your student market isn't there, or if you're unhappy with the way that works out, you can rent it out to a family who will then help to make that property grow for you. Thanks for being with us tonight. We are here to answer your questions, but asking them could mean that you also win a copy of one of my books. Call, email or tweet your question to us, and at the end of the show, each tweet, email and caller whose questions that we use tonight will score a copy of one of my 8 books. This week it's How to Achieve Property Success, which is a great book about every step of the investing process. Call us on 1300 30 3435, tweet me at Margaret Lomas AU with the hashtag YMYC, or email property at skynews.com.au with your question. And if we answer it tonight, make sure you watch at the end of the show to see how to get hold of your copy. Now, we do have to head off for our first break. Don't go away. When we come back, we'll continue the discussion and get on with as many of your questions as we can. We'll be right back here soon with more. I'm glad that you tuned in tonight, where Noel Petrohelos from BMT Tax Depreciation and Rich Harvey from Property Buyer are standing by to take your questions. Now, you can ask one by calling us now on 1300 30 34 35, tweeting me on Margaret Lomas AU with the hashtag YMYC, or emailing us on property at skynews.com.au. Let's go to the line, and Scott, you're on the phone. How are you going, Scott?
Good, thank you, Margaret. How are you?
Good. What can we do for you, Scott?
Look, I'm just. I purchased an apartment in Northmead, in the northwest of Sydney, back in 2009, mm-hmm. and settled in 2013, and took 4 years to build the thing. Mm-hmm. But I've actually done quite well out of it over the past few years, and I'm considering selling and then actually investing in the two cheaper properties, probably in regional towns. So I guess my question for the panel is, what's your thoughts on Northmead as a suburb and growth going forward?
Okay. So Northmead, around about 25 kilometres from Sydney, up near Baulkham Hills there. Not exactly an area that people would be rushing to the units, but it's also not oversupplied for units. Selling up and investing in regional towns, I don't know, that makes me feel really uncomfortable.
Yeah, I've got to say, look, Scott, I think Northmead's a great area in terms of potential growth. You've got Westmead as well, where over the next 20 years, there are going to be around 50,000 jobs created through the Westmead Hospital precinct. You've got the Westmead General Hospital, you've got the Teaching Hospital, and you've got the Children's Hospital there. So there is a lot of infrastructure. You've also got the light rail coming through from Parramatta. And all of that is going to bode well for the property market. So I just take a really careful look at perhaps even trying to revalue your properties, harvest the equity off rather than selling that property. I think you're probably possibly better off holding it for the longer term, because you've got transaction costs getting out of that property and then back into your next property. So I think you've got to really weigh up your numbers and see if it's going to work for you.
What do you think, Noel?
If I was in that exact same situation, I would be leveraging that property and using that equity to buy. I mean, the strategy that he's going at, not necessarily regional. Regional areas are fine, but going into that lower entry point, I think, is really smart. But he doesn't need to sell. He's bought in the right time. He's gone through a good capital growth cycle. He'd have plenty of equity there in that property. And as Rich meant, there's plenty of employment and infrastructure and transport in that area. It has had a good run in the last 2 years, but it's not going to go anywhere, I don't think, personally. I think it's either going to level out a little bit and keep ticking away over the next couple of years. And he's got an opportunity there to get that equity out and leverage into another probably couple of properties. If he's done his numbers right at the start and not leveraged too hard at the start, there should be enough there to do that anyway, even if he goes one and then waits a year, gets another valuation and gets some equity out and then go again. And then you've got that second property there to potentially add value to your portfolio as well, to grow your portfolio. It's the best way to go from my angle.
Scott, so many, many things that I could be talking to you about right now that jump into my mind. I spend a lot of time, as you know, going around the country and assessing different areas and their capacity to grow at some time in the future, because future growth becomes more important to us than what's happening right now. There are many times when I feel there are certain regions that are on the verge of having a really good, great growth spurt, but I'm not seeing any right now. Right now, what I am seeing is the outer suburbs of some of our larger capital cities as potential areas to get some good growth. I don't necessarily include Sydney in this, because I do think Sydney is coming to the end of the bull run, and I definitely think it will plateau. I don't think you're in danger of losing value in that property. One of the things I can tell you about capital gain is that it's worth more to you unrealised than it is to you realised. The moment you get out of that property, then you will pay capital gains tax on the gain. And that is going to cut about 25% or so off what you've just made. Instead, that 25% could be a deposit on a whole other property. And if you buy in some of those suburbs outside of Melbourne that are still in the low 300s and situated in demographically dense areas with strong employment drivers, or even some of those suburbs of Brisbane that we've talked about on this show many, many times, that seem to me to have inevitable growth to come for years and years on end, then you'll end up doing what's most important as a property investor, which is you'll be building a portfolio of properties. It's my opinion that if you sell your Sydney property to get into the regions, you may be very well disappointed that you did so and that you didn't hang on to what looks to me to be a pretty good and strong asset right now. Well, I'm often warning people about how they buy property. And this question from Matthew will, I'm sure, draw some good advice from my panel. He asks, I would appreciate your thoughts on a new investment townhouse in Elengrove, Brisbane. It's in a complex with nearly 200 townhouses. All of them are the same. Three beds, two bathrooms, one car space. I was shown this investment property by a finance broker. Do you think this is a good idea, or do you have any alternative investment locations around Brisbane? Noel.
Margaret.
Let's just leave out the location for a moment.
It's not a bad spot.
And talk of, well, we'll talk about that in a minute, and talk about the fact that he has been shown this property, one of 200 identical properties, by his finance broker. What are the chances that the finance broker's just a good bloke trying to give him a hot tip?
Look, there's not a great chance of that, Margaret. And look, I'm not going to say that it's not necessarily bad advice, but what needs to be clear is who's getting what out of this sale. So you really need to investigate that scenario. And when someone is you know, they're making their bit out of pushing someone into a particular development, they need to be really careful and make sure that they're giving the advice based on the right economic drivers and not what's happening in their back pocket.
Which is probably around 25 to 30 grand, to be honest.
Look, if you see those kind, you do see those kind of things happening. There's no doubt, and it's a worry.
You're just too nice. Tell me about Elengrove.
It's about 20 kilometres southwest of Brisbane. It's a really good growth corridor. You know, those areas there are a lot of townhouses and developments like that. The concern I have a little bit with this is the sheer size of this project and the fact that it mentions in here that they're all identical, which to me, when you're trying to, you know, if you're going onto a resale and you're trying to have your property stand out either for a valuation or you're in an emergency and you need to sell, you know, that can cause a problem because you've only got another 199 properties to compare it to, which is a little bit of a concern.
Now, I'm going to come back to you in a minute because I know that if I don't get off air soon, I'm going to get in trouble because we have some important messages to announce. But keep those questions coming to us to be in the running for my book. For now, though, it's time to go for another break, but we will be back soon. If you do have a question for us, call on 1300 30 34 35. Tweet me to Margaret Lomas AU with the hashtag YMYC or email property at skynews.com.au. We'll be right back soon with more of the show. Welcome back and thanks for tuning in tonight for our property edition of Your Money, Your Call. I'm Margaret Lomas from Destiny Financial Solutions. And tonight, Noel Petrohelos from BMT Tax Depreciation and Rich Harvey from Property Buyer are answering your questions. So call us now on 1300 30 34 35. Tweet Margaret Lomas AU with the hashtag YMYC or you can email us on property at skynews.com.au. Robert, how are you going, Robert?
John McGrath's been very vocal for about a year or 18 months now in relation to what he terms the Golden Triangle, which is basically property from the Gold Coast to Brisbane to Toowoomba, excluding high-rise in Surfers Paradise, etc. I'm talking about the suburban areas of the Gold Coast, that northern corridor leading to Brisbane, the Brisbane area and Toowoomba. he's basically said, you know, ad nauseam that he wouldn't be buying property anywhere else in Australia for the next 5 years other than that golden triangle.
Mm.
Interested in your views.
Mm. Well, I like it when people get on the bandwagon very late in the piece, Rich,
yes.
Because we were talking about those many southern suburbs of Brisbane a good 7 years ago, which is, well, eight now. Mm. I first invested there myself 8 years ago, and the property I bought's already doubled once.
Mm. Yeah.
I got in under 100,000 in some of those suburbs. Mm. It's already doubled for me once, and I see much more to come.
Mm.
I'm not sure about... I think you need to be careful when you use Gold Coast in, you know, in the language there, because there's certainly parts of Gold Coast, in my opinion, that you must steer clear of. And as Robert pointed out, high-rise not included.
I think Robert sort of... I mean, John McGrath's casting a very wide net. I mean, it's a bit like saying investing in Western Sydney is a good idea, and it is, but you've got to be very specific about which suburbs you're buying in. I think, look, Toowoomba, definitely a good area. It has had a good run. You've got the private airport that's been completed and the bypass that's now going through. Certainly parts of Brisbane are definitely are really going to be performing. They haven't performed as much as anyone has thought, and I think jobs growth has been the real limiting factor in Brisbane, as well as also, Margaret, a potential oversupply in certain pockets of Brisbane.
Mm-hmm.
And the Gold Coast, as you said, look, I'm quite pro-Gold Coast, but again, very cautious about exactly where you buy. I think the next, excuse me, the next couple of years, the Gold Coast is going to pick up quite substantially. But like anything, Robert, you've got to be very specific about where you buy, what it is you're trying to buy in terms of a strategy. But overall, I do think those areas will have some uplift. But also, McGrath's got a personal interest in boosting sales to there because he's got new offices opening there as
well. Yeah, absolutely. It's interesting, isn't it? You've got to be careful about things like that. No.
It's a large area. And like a lot of those large areas, there are markets within markets. I like some of those outer ring Brisbane areas. I think Gold Coast, you know, there's works going on with the Commonwealth Games and the light rail, but that's to me that's more of a moment in time more so than anything else. You know, heading out towards Toowoomba and through Ipswich and all that area, there's lots of little pockets there that I think will do really well, including the area we just talked about before. You've got to consider the type of property that you're targeting those areas, and I think your older style home with a big block of land where you can get some land content is a good option to go for within those areas, and places like Logan that you've talked about for years that have performed amazingly well and still, I think, still have some growth. Brisbane has ticked away fairly slowly in the same time when Melbourne and Sydney have really shot through. And I think in the next couple of years, we're going to see some migration out of those markets and into Brisbane and into that triangle for sure. There's going to be some catch-up time, definitely. It's just a matter of doing some research on the particular areas and looking at the different drivers within those areas and making sure you select the right place.
Mm. You know, there's been so much attention on that golden triangle, and I don't like the use of that word because I don't think it is a golden triangle. As the boys have so rightly pointed out, there are areas in that triangle that you shouldn't be buying in. And even though I really love Ipswich, and I was a huge proponent of Ipswich 8-9 years ago, I think now you're a little bit too late, and I think Ipswich overheated a little bit, and I probably wouldn't be buying there for a little while as an investment. It's the happiest place in Australia, according to Melbourne University. Believe it or not, Deakin University, it's the happiest place. They did a study and said Ipswich was the happiest place in Australia.
Wow.
If you go there, people are very happy. But at the moment, it's probably not the happiest place to be buying. I think what's being overlooked in Brisbane is certainly some of those northern suburbs right up the Northern Corridor, where the new rail line has just been completed into Rothwell and is going to continue over the years. People are just ignoring that at the moment, and we still have a really good low buy-in price, but plenty of population growth. Everyone's focusing down on that golden triangle, and it's becoming overheated because of that. You've got to buy, Robert, somewhere where people aren't talking about. You can't be buying there, particularly if John McGrath is telling everyone to buy there, you need to find somewhere else and think about the things that make property grow and find the areas that haven't had the attention just yet. We also have a Robert who has sent in an email, and he says, I'm just inquiring about building allowance at 2.5%. Will this reduce your cost base? If you sell your investment unit at a profit, the gain will be bigger and capital gains tax will be more. Is this correct? I'm going to go straight to you on this one, Noel. Now, this is one of the great, not so much fair fees, but the great misunderstood adjustments.
It is very misunderstood for a couple of reasons, but the short answer is yes, it does. Your cost base is reduced by the amount that you claim on your building write-off. The The great thing about it all is if you hold that property for 12 months, you get a 50% capital gains tax exemption. So you're reducing your cost base by the deduction you're claiming, and you're claiming that at your full marginal rate, and it's clawed back at half your marginal rate. Now, depreciation is a deduction that's available to you sometimes throughout the financial year if you're doing a pay-as-you-go withholding variation, or when you do your tax return at the end of the year. That money can be used then to, you know, offset some interest or reinvest. That's money in your pocket that you should get hold of. You don't want that sitting somewhere else. Now, when you go to sell the property, there is legislation that says you need to calculate that loss anyway.
So that's the thing.
So you might as well claim it.
They say I'm not claiming it because I have to pay it back, but you have to account for it whether you've claimed it or not.
That's right.
But you know what, Noel, we need to make clear to the viewers here that it isn't a straight calculation whereby if you claimed, say you got a total of $10,000 in tax back along the way, it isn't $10,000 that gets paid back. It doesn't work. The calculation doesn't work like that. It's whatever you claimed in a depreciation amount gets accounted for, and then it's halved, and then it's your marginal rate of tax.
That's right.
So what
it's halved, so it's scaled right down.
So it's a small amount. So what you get in hand is usually, let's just say, a lot more than what you then miss out on keeping from the gain at the end.
That's right. And any accountant with any background in accounting, which most of them should have, can sit there and do a very basic calculation. So it actually surprises me how much this question comes up. I think I get asked this every second day
by
an investor, and then I have to I explain it to them how it works, and sometimes I draw some pictures and do a little calculation and send it off to them. But it's a simple answer that the deduction's there to be claimed. That money is opportunity money for you to have in your pocket straight away.
And let's not forget the time value of money. If it's 20 years before you do it, that the tiny bit of the tiny bit that we worked out is only a tiny bit, is a tinier bit.
That's right.
Because it's actually worth a different amount than it is to you today. It's worth a lot more to you today than it is tomorrow.
It's a good old-fashioned no-brainer, but you have to, you know, where it comes from, I don't know, but do those basic calcs, and you're much better off claiming that and then dealing with the CGT or the capital gains tax issue later, which is going to be only a very scaled down portion of it.
Particularly if you sell them one at a time in retirement when you're on a lower marginal rate of tax as well.
That's right.
See, this just keeps getting better and better.
There is one more thing.
There's one more thing. What is it?
That your plant and equipment, which is your depreciation on your fixtures and fittings, is treated completely separately.
You don't have to do it with that. So it's only the building.
So it's only that 2.5% on the building write-off.
So it just got more negligible again.
That's right.
Pretty soon we're going to have it completely written off altogether. Just stay with us and see how
that's right.
Let's go to the phones and Shane from Sydney. How can we help you?
Yes, hello. I have got an investment property done in surveying our waters, and I wonder if it's a good investment or not for the outlook of the area.
Okay. So
what do you think about that?
All right. Sylvania Waters, I always think of that old show years ago. I never watched it, actually, because I don't think I was allowed to. I was young then. Maybe I was allowed to. Maybe I wasn't that young. Was it Nolene or something? I don't know.
Watch the soapies there.
I don't know. No, it wasn't a soapy. It was actually probably Australia's first ever reality TV show.
Right.
Because it was about a real family who lived in Sylvania Waters. And they were allowed to have they allowed the cameras to come into their home and film them, warts and all. So it was really Australia's answer to the Kardashians, I guess. Sylvania Waters.
Yeah, well, Sylvania Waters, it's a lovely part of the Shire, as it's colloquially known. Mm. And I think Sylvania Waters, it's always been talked up as a bit of like a Gold Coast within Sydney, you know, with you have your house on the water and your little boat ramp out the back and you can travel off wherever you like. Look, I think it's definitely got potential. Anyone that wants, you know, a waterfront property should look in the Shire area. I mean, compared to places like Mossman and Cremorne, where you're spending, you know, $10 million for a waterfront, Sylvania Waters is pretty good value, you've got to say, you know. But it is further from the city.
But let's face it, as an investment, if you are a pure investor listening to this show, I wouldn't want anyone to go, oh, my gosh, we need to all go and invest in Sylvania Waters. It is a great place to live and the properties will retain their value. But the yield along the way is going to be so abysmal because it probably yields about 2.5% a year. And once those interest rates start to rise a little bit, which they inevitably will, that's going to hurt badly. And I don't think the gain to cover that is yet to come. Mm. I think we've seen that really good gain. We'll plateau for a while, like Sydney always does, for probably 8 to 10 years. And during that time, you're going to hurt if you're only getting...
Well, the other strategy investors can use, if they do want to invest in Sylvania, is what is buy a property you can subdivide, cut it in half or add a flat, and that's the way you can...
That's the way you can add
some value and also create a higher yield.
You look like you want to say something there, Noel.
No, I was just writing down all of your advice. But look, it's a lovely waterfront area that's, you know, hinged off Sydney's growth that Sydney's had, and it's all of its surrounding suburbs in the last couple of years. It's had 18 to 20% per year in the last 12 months. You know, you've got to think about where that property clock is at with those areas, what your entry buy-in and what your alternatives are, because it is a large entry into the investment market. It's a low yield, as you mentioned, Margaret, which, you know, right now I think that there's some options for especially first-time investors to get into that are going to do a little bit better in the short term.
Well, you already own a property there and there's nothing preventing you from keeping it, particularly if your cash flows are okay and you're managing it. But to other people who are watching the show, let me say that one of the most important things about investing in property is the capacity to build a portfolio of properties, not just buy one and sit on it and cross your fingers and hope that another boom comes around to improve your net worth. If you can go out and buy quite a number of properties and build a nice portfolio and have them in all different geographical areas around the country, be getting a reasonable cash flow along the way, but be buying in areas that will grow, then over time you're going to have a better overall result than that one expensive property that you buy and just hope nothing goes wrong in terms of growth in the future. I don't see anything in Sydney that will make growth go backward, but I do see that we're reaching a point where the number of people who can afford to pay the prices is becoming fewer and fewer, and pretty soon the wind has to come out of the sails and we will see property prices plateau for a while. To me, it's not a great place to invest right now, but certainly if you already own property in Sydney, you've now got a great base from which you can leverage into other properties and look for some markets that are on their way up from here. Well, there's much more still to come, but we do have a few messages for you. When we come back, you'll have another chance to get hold of a copy of my book, How to Achieve Property Success. But you will have to ask a question and have it answered tonight. If you like the sound of that, then 1300 30 34 35. Tweet Margaret Lomas AU with the hashtag YMYC, or you can also email us on property@skynews.com.au. We'll be right back here soon with more. Welcome back to Your Money, Your Call. I'm Margaret Lomas from Destiny Financial Solutions. And joining me tonight, Noel Petrohelos from BMT Tax Depreciation and Rich Harvey from Property Buyer. Our lines are closed for tonight, but we do have time for these last questions. And before we go to them, let's take a look at the last piece of news for this week. And authorities will begin door-knocking residents of at least 70 homes on Sydney's North Shore to make way for the long-awaited Northern Beaches Road Tunnel, the state government has announced. However, frustrated commuters will have to wait at least another 6 years to use the tunnel, with New South Wales Premier Gladys Berejiklian refusing to specify when it would be delivered or how much it would cost. The Beaches Link Tunnel is set to cross under the Middle Harbour, connecting the Warringah Freeway to the Burnt Bridge Creek deviation at Balgowla. Rich, people are going to love this tunnel because that... Have you driven from the Northern Beaches along Military Road to the city?
I have driven along... And I'll tell you what, the previous Premier, Mike Baird, actually ran from the Spit Bridge to Neutral Bay one day to prove that he could run faster than the bus.
That's right, I remember that.
And he beat it. So good on him. So there's a case in point. But look, what this tunnel's going to do, it's going to knock out 19 sets of traffic lights, improve travel time by about 40 minutes. So it's going to bring a really long-awaited boost to the Northern Beaches.
Yeah, because that doesn't seem to grow like the rest of Sydney does. It tends to get left a bit behind, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, look, I think the Northern Beaches is sort of a little... It's a beautiful peninsula.
There's village.
Gorgeous,
like a village.
Absolutely. There's some gorgeous little enclaves there. It's had stellar capital growth, and I think it will have some really good capital growth. And this is one of those things that when you have a big infrastructure project like this, you tend to get a really intensive spike in inquiry when it's announced, and then after it's completed, when the travel times are realised, then people go, wow, it's actually not that far from the city. I'll go and live there. So it's a good for lifestyle.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a great addition. Once they also finish the freeway, the M1 extension as well.
Correct.
Which means that from Carryong, I think, to the airport, there's only two sets of lights, which
That's
is
right.
the ones at the airport.
Mm,
so yeah. you go all that way.
And this tunnel will also connect up with the beginning of the Lane Cove tunnel as well. So we'll, it's
integrated. Let's just hope they make it wide enough then. Mm. Let's go to the phones and Sam, you're on the line. How are you going, Sam?
Not too bad, thank you. Thank you for taking my call.
You're welcome. What can we do for you?
I just have a quick question about the Logan area in Queensland.
Mm-hmm.
I did a bit of research. The house there reasonable to back up with a number. However, I found that the criminal rate and the income of the average income was a bit low.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just a bit concerned, you know, about the area. I just want to get a thought from the panel please.
Mm.
Thank you.
No, this is a typical one where people worry about the present moment and don't think about the changing demographic that happens over time.
That's right. And these kind of areas like Logan, I mean, it's changed a lot already.
Already.
But it just seems to keep evolving. And I know you've been talking about Logan, and we've all been talking about Logan on this show for a long time, but I still think it's got legs to keep going. And for that reason, and again, going back to what we were talking about before, that other areas are becoming exhausted in New South Wales and Victoria, and people are going to be targeting these areas. And Logan is, you know, it seems to be still a hotspot. In my books, it's got still a relatively cheap buy-in. The yields are strong. What you mentioned before, go for the areas that have sat there and haven't done a whole heap in the last 18 months. And even though it has performed, it's ticked away a little bit, more so than had a big boost. And don't worry too much about those bits and pieces about employment and average incomes.
Mm. And just quickly from you, Rich, Pam Parker, Mayor of Logan, has spent a lot of time and money trying to beautify the area, trying to really bring interest to the area. You know, infill development's now allowed as well, so a change to the town plan. There's not a lot to not like there.
Oh, I think we love Logan. We're buying sort of one to two properties a week there for our clients. Mm. We're finding we're getting established houses and getting yields around 6%.
Excellent.
Adding a granny flat, we're boost the yield to around 8%. But like, I think, you know, don't be, for Sam, you shouldn't be so concerned about the crime rate. You can investigate the statistics and get scared off by that, but there are some great areas of Logan, some family-friendly areas. It's all about picking the right streets and the right properties within those suburbs.
Absolutely. Mm. Absolutely. Now we have an email from Liam, and Liam asks, I'm currently building a property in Tumba, New South Wales, where I will reside once complete. I'll have an LVR of around 90% on completion, and I was wondering if I'm better off putting my current savings in to pay down the LVR to below 80%. Looking for my first investment property. This is a nice quickie to answer.
Mm. Well, Tullamar, south of Wollongong, I think, Margaret, it depends on Liam's strategy. I think the first thing he's got to do is get some independent advice and look at his strategy. If he's sort of in the what I call the accumulation phase, in the early stage of his career, I'd be saying to him, look, you know, it's a... Get some investment properties going as well as building your home. Don't just wait till you've paid off your home, but don't over-leverage yourself. I think it's really important to get financial advice around not over-leveraging but doing it safely to go forward.
I think more importantly, Liam, what you need to do here, though, is take the cash and put it into the house. Absolutely put it into the house. That creates equity for you to then borrow back to buy those investment properties using a 100% loan on the investment properties. If you use the cash to buy the investment properties, and you know this, don't you, Noel? I can see you nodding over there that's you agree, don't
yes,
you?
Yes, that's right.
If you use the cash to buy the investment properties and you've got a high LVR on your own home, you've got a big non-deductible loan there.
That's right.
Smaller deductible.
You want the maximum amount of debt on the property that's producing income because it is deductible debt, very simple, and as least amount of debt as possible on your primary place of residence. And
absolutely.
You've got to manage it, and manage it using, I use offset accounts to manage that debt and make sure it's right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep. And look, offset accounts might work, but once you want to grab the equity back out, it's got to get paid into the loan. The offset account doesn't
That's
work
right.
then.
Yep.
Otherwise, it becomes cash again. So understand, offset's good for offsetting interest, but when you need to leverage against equity, you don't want to pull that cash out of offset and use it as a deposit on the investment property. You want to transfer it into the debt, pay the debt down, use the equity to create the deposit, which is then fully geared into the investment property. Absolutely need some good advice on this one, but keep chipping away at your own home as quickly as you can.
Yeah.
Quickly, I want to go back to that email that you didn't get to answer about the fellow who wanted to buy an Ellengrove, one of 200 properties.
That's right.
Some red flags going up.
Yeah, I think that Matthew's email about buying an Ellengrove, I think my comment was going to be to Matthew, don't buy a Truman Show type property where they just all look the plain vanilla and all really boring. I think it's really important that you buy a property that's got some good land content, that has the right attributes for long-term value. And we've talked about, and you mentioned about the broker getting a commission, make sure they're getting independent advice. So it's, you know, I would say to Matthew, there are other definitely better alternatives out there. Don't just go for something that's just a hot tip from your broker.
And look, I agree with Noel. I think the area is great. That entire area there is a good area to buy in. I would never buy in a development of 200 properties, because when you go to sell, there is always going to be a dozen others also on the market. Nothing to differentiate yours. You're competing property for property there, and it's going to come down to the wire, and you'll lose money that way. I guarantee you this broker is getting a commission. Ask him to tell you how much. I bet he won't tell you, but ask, because he doesn't have to. But ask him to tell you how much, and then maybe ask him to give it back to you. That's probably a good way to get a good discount on that property. Well, that's a wrap for this week. If you still have any remaining questions, do get them to me through the week, and we'll try to use them on next week's show. Thank you to my guests, Noel and Rich. Both will return again later in the year. And thanks to our callers. If we did answer your question on the show tonight, email me on yourmoneyyourcallatdestiny.com.au. You can see that on your screen, yourmoneyyourcallatdestiny.com.au. Tell me which question you asked and provide me with your mailing address, and I'll send you your book. If you have a question or want to contact me between shows, try Twitter at @MargaretLomasAU, Instagram at @MargaretLomasProperty, or via my website, destiny.com.au, where you can also get some great educational content, podcasts and video blogs. Now, they're all free of charge and a must watch if you're looking to build a property investment portfolio. And please make sure you stay tuned to my social media. There are some exciting changes to my company, Destiny, which will make it even easier to access not only all the wonderful educational tools that we have, but my personal information and advice. Check out Facebook and Instagram to find out more about that. I'll be back next week. Meanwhile, have a great week, and I'll see you then.
The information featured in this program is general in nature and therefore should not be relied upon. Guests appearing on the program may have commercial arrangements with some of the companies mentioned. Before making any investment, insurance or financial planning decisions, you should consult a licensed professional who can advise whether your decision is appropriate for you.